Luke chapter number 23. Seems like everything's going backwards today for some reason. But anyhow, we'll get through it, okay? I want to start reading, if I could, in Luke chapter 23. Let me go back and to the 32nd verse and come on down, if I could. It said, there were two other malefactors led with him to be put to death. And when they were come to the place which is called Calvary. Now this is the only place in your Bible that it calls it that, Calvary. The other three Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and John, calls it Golgotha. Golgotha means a skull or the shape of a skull. I've had the privilege of going there. I've had the privilege to go up to the top of Calvary. It is not a big old mountain, okay? All through my boyhood, childhood, I thought it was some elevated mountain of awful, but it isn't. It's about maybe 20 feet high, if it's that high. And they won't let you go up it anymore. When I was there, they would, but they've stopped it because of safety reasons. But they, for whatever reason, Luke calls it Calvary, okay? But none of the rest of the writers call it Calvary. But we'll bear with that. And there it crucified him. And the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. And then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And that's what I preached on last Sunday morning. Is Jesus on that cross didn't think of himself, but he thought of others. He thought of me and you. And he asked God to forgive them. He's not only talking about the people surrounding that cross, the soldiers, Pilate, Herod, all the rest of them that's got him on that cross, but I think he's talking about me and you also. The Lord knew that one day you and I would come along and we needed to be forgiven also. And he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. How many times you and I have gone out and done the wrong thing, not knowing what we was doing, not knowing, you know, that this is against God, not knowing that, hey, this is sin. And we didn't know that, and we just went out and did it blindly, so to speak. The Bible says the God of this world, which is referring to Satan, the God of this world had blinded us. And I know I walked around this world for many years blinded and did some awful things. But he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what to do. And they parted his raiment and cast lots. And the people stood beholding, and the rulers also with them derided him, saying, He saved others. Let him save himself if he be Christ, the chosen of God. And the soldiers also mocked him, coming to him and offering him of vinegar and say, If thou be the king of the Jews, save thyself. And a superscription also was written over him in letters of Greek and Latin and Hebrew. And those letters said, This is the king of the Jews. And one of the malefactors, which was for hanged, railed on him, said, If thou be the Christ, if thou be Christ, say thyself and us. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, Does not thou fear God, seeing that thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we received the due reward of our deeds, but this man hath done nothing amiss. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, here's the second saying from the cross now, Verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. Jesus started his ministry with prayer, and last week we saw him offer that prayer. Now today, there on Calvary, or Golgotha, whichever you wish to call it, You're going to see his second words. He wasn't praying, but you're going to see him answer the first prayer he prayed. When he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He's fixing to answer that here with one of the men on the cross next to him. One on the right and one on the left. And this, he answers that prayer very plainly. Now, what I want to deal with is two things. Number one, I want to deal with the request of that man on the cross next to him. I want you to notice two or three things. That thief on the cross, although he was suffering, although he was hurting, although he knew he was fixing to die too, all that, he did not ask Jesus to get rid of his suffering.
Amen.
He did not ask him. Now, before this, I think in Matthew's gospel, it'll tell you that both of these thieves on the cross had reviled him, said things to him sarcastically, like some people know how to do. Amen. And there's just people in this world know how to say things they shouldn't say. Amen. Y'all don't have to take that. Just go with it. But anyhow, this one didn't ask, say, I'm hurting. Could you help me? Could you do something? Cause it to rain, maybe, and let me open my mouth and get some water. I'm sure he was thirsty. But no, he didn't ask all that. And Jesus is right in the middle of two thieves. Now you think about this. This is God. Amen. This is Jehovah hanging there on that cross. And yet he's got a thief on the left and he's got a thief on the right. What company? What kind of company he should do? Why is he hanging between two thieves? Why didn't they hang him separately, by the way? Why didn't they pick another day to crucify the Lord? Why did they put him between two thieves? Turn to Isaiah chapter 53. The 53rd chapter of the book of Isaiah. And I'm going to read all of it. That's a lot better than my preaching, I'm sure. The Word of God is. This is 700 years before Jesus was born. Isaiah, the prophet, wrote this down. He said, who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form, nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there's no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrow and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrow. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken, and he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his day, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul, and he shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall any righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquity. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death. And he was numbered, here it is, and he was numbered with the transgressors. Why did he hang between those two thieves? To fulfill God's holy word.
Amen.
Isaiah pinned this down 700 years before it happened. And then some idiot tries to tell me that this Bible isn't inspired. You've got to be a double idiot to believe that. You don't even have a BB in your boxcar. My word, all you got to do, Brother Judson did a great job of this morning. The Word of God, how we need to get back to what the Bible said. I could care less what the Republicans say and the Democrats say. Amen. I want to hear what God, the creator of this world, what God says about the matter. And you need to find that out too. You don't need to go get some PhD degree to understand the Word of God. If you're saved, you have a teacher that will teach you the Word of God.
Amen.
Amen. And he's the one that wrote the Word of God.
Amen.
These two male factors are there. One on the right, one on the left, being crucified along with the Lord. And as they're there, one of them started again saying to Jesus, if you be the Christ, do so and so. He doesn't have to do anything to prove himself. Amen. He was born the Savior of the world. He was born God. Amen. In John 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God.
Amen.
He's always been, he always has been.
Amen.
And hey, you or I are never going to surprise him by what we say or what we do, because he is so, if I could use the earthly word, intelligent.
Amen.
He knows all things. Amen.
Amen.
I'm glad I'm serving one that knows all things. Before I ever bow my knee, before I ever ask him something, he's already got the answer waiting.
Amen.
Amen. I'm thankful I serve a God like that. I don't serve Buddha, whatever his name is, Buddha, or Muhammad, or whatever his name is. I serve a living God. His name is Jehovah.
Amen.
Amen. Elohim. Jehovah Jireh. Shalom. He has many names. They all mean something. You do your Bible study and find that out. But here, the dying thief requested one thing. He said, remember me. Did you notice he didn't ask that he remembered the other thief? He didn't ask that. I think there's a reason for that. I think this thief has something going.
Amen.
I think the other thief has been reveling, or however you say it, been mocking, making fun of Jesus, and there was no hope for him. But he says to the Lord, remember me. Remember me when you cannot come into your kingdom. Wait a minute now. Think about it. Let your mind get in gear now. Get it in gear. He's asking him something to do after death, because Jesus is going to be crucified. So he believes in the resurrection. No more on the cross, believing in the resurrection, because he's asking, he said, remember me after, not right now, after you come into paradise. Remember me. He believed in the resurrection. He believed in the dead coming out of the grave one day. Hallelujah. I believe that. Amen. The Bible teaches that. Amen. But this thief on the cross is asking for something and showing to Jesus, I don't think he realized it, but he's showing to Jesus that he believed in the resurrection. Not only did he believe in the resurrection, he believed of the coming of the Lord. He said, when you come.
Amen.
He didn't say when you are. He said, when you come. When you come. I mean, Jesus is coming again.
Amen.
You said, well, I've heard that preach all my life. Well, listen at it one more time. He's coming. And in the hour you expect not, or you think not, he's going to show up. And I'll say this to you this morning, church. Not many people expect him to come today. Not many people. And we're guilty. We're getting such a routine, running here and yonder, doing this and that, and we forget about it. This could be the day. This could be the day that God has set on his calendar, I'm going to send my son back, and I'm going to get my family and bring them up here. Those that have been redeemed, those that have been saved. The Bible said there'll be two in the field working, one will be taken and another left. The Bible said there'll be two in the bed, one will be taken and the other left. He's coming.
Amen.
And this old boy is hanging on the cross there next to Jesus. I don't know if he's on his right or left. I looked and the Bible never specifies that whatsoever. But he's hanging on that cross and he said, remember me. He didn't say, Lord, I'm hurting, help me. Just remember. May I ask you a question? Have you ever gotten that serious with God? Have you ever really got down to the nitty-gritty and a personal asking God to save you? Amen. It's personal, by the way.
Amen.
I can't do it for you. No other preacher or person can do it for you. Your mama can't do it for you. Daddy can't do it for you. You're not going to go to heaven hanging on your grandma's apron strings. I get it right. But remember me. That's how he addressed it. But notice otherwise, look what he called it. He didn't say, hey, old man upstairs. He didn't say a lot of these cliches a lot of people like to say nowadays that is blasphemy as far as I'm concerned. He said, Lord. He didn't say Jesus. He said, Lord. If you're going to get something done for you, it's going to be the Lord.
Amen.
Jesus is his earthly name. Lord is his deity name. He is God. And when you recognize him as Lord, you remember the Apostle Paul? On the road to Damascus, and he was struck down by a bright shining light, which was the Lord Jesus Christ. You go there in Acts chapter 9 or 10, I forget which. But anyhow, you go there and read it when you get home and see what the Apostle Paul called him. He didn't say Jesus. He didn't say good feller. He said, Lord, what would you have me to do? When you get out of business, you're calling Lord. May I say this to us? Everyone in this building this morning needs a Lord. Now you can make a Lord out of other things. Whatever you want to choose. And there's plenty out there to choose from, okay? Popularity, riches, I could go on and on. I don't know, you know what I'm talking about. But you can make, you know people, and I've met people, that just worship things. I had a fellow in my church one time. I won't call names because you probably know it. But I had a man in my church one time. And he was a good he told me he was saved. And I believe that. I took his word for it. I still take his word for it. But his goal in life was to make $1 million. Did he make it? Yeah, he did. But I don't know what his goal is now. After he's made $1 million, he's surely not a happy man. He's surely not serving God. But he made $1 million. He's got a Lord. Now, if something happens to that $1 million, I don't know what he's going to do. And he's getting old. He's over 9. That's getting old. Lord, remember me. If he had called him by any other name, I don't believe Jesus would have answered. I believe when a person gets saved, when the Holy Spirit brings you under conviction, he's going to introduce you to someone called Lord. And then you do business with the Lord. You don't do business with the church or another person that's talking with you. You do business with the Lord. He's the one that's able to forgive your sin.
Amen.
Is the Lord. And this thief called upon him as Lord. Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. The old boy believes some things, but still, it's going to take Jesus. And here comes the second saying, what Jesus said to him. We studied saying number one last Sunday. Here's number two. When Jesus said unto him, verily, what a wonderful word in your Bible, verily. We don't say that anymore. We use another word in the Christian realm. Amen. So be it. I imagine when that old thief on that cross heard that, so be it. He asked for something. And Jesus said, so be it. Woo. Y'all ain't getting happy about it, I do. Thank God. Jesus said, well, we got to open the book and see how you've been doing. And he said, well, now let me check you out and get a credit report on you or something. Let me talk to your neighbors and see how you act around the house. Let me talk to those people you work with every day, and let me see what, let me look at it, and I'll talk with you. He said, verily, so be it. Jesus gave him, oh boy, a personal answer. If you'll notice, he didn't say, well, let me call the Father and see what he thinks. He was talking to the Father.
Amen.
Say, explain that, preacher. Ain't got time. And I doubt you would comprehend it when I told you. But he gave him a personal answer. I say unto thee, I'm not saying this to somebody else, this is personal. When God deals with you, he's not dealing with a crowd. He's dealing with you personally.
Amen.
Personally, God said, hey, this or that or the other. And here's Jesus saying to him, I say unto thee, I'm talking to you. I'm not talking to the other thief. I'm not talking to the crowd around the cross. There his mama and his mama's sister and Mary Magdalene and John was there. And I'm not talking to them. I'm talking to you. I say unto thee, we'll wait and see how you come up. We'll wait a while. Let me give you a few days. and see how it do. No, he said, today. I'm glad salvation is instantaneous.
Amen.
I'm glad you don't have to be put on a wait list. I'm glad God don't have to do a report on you. You're guilty. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You're guilty as a dog. I'm guilty. Lord, remember me. Today, not tomorrow, today. There was folks, Jesus and him was fixing to die. He said, today, I like prompt answers. These telemarkers call me at 7 o'clock in the morning on my cell phone on a Sunday morning. What do you say, preacher? No, you best not know. I didn't say nothing. I said click. Click. You just won a cruise to the Bahamas. I said, well, I already won 3. You've been approved for thousands of dollars. I don't need it. One of them called me the other day from J.C. Penney and said, you've been approved, Mr. Allen, for, I forget how much, life insurance. I said, well, I have to die for that to be any good. Hey, and that doesn't sound like a good deal to me. He said, but you don't understand. I said, I do understand. I understand perfectly. Life insurance, somebody has to die before it benefits anybody. And I said, ma'am, I'm going to tell you something. I'm married to a wonderful woman. And you think I'm going to leave her that much money down here to dance around? You know, she started laughing. I said, you're wasting your time, ma'am. I've got plenty of insurance, I promise. Today, thou shalt. Didn't say pray about it. Didn't say think about it. He said, today thou shalt be with me. I like that.
Amen.
I want to be with him.
Amen.
You can have all the rest of it. I want to be with him.
Amen.
With me in paradise. Not purgatory. Oh, he got quiet. If you show me in the Bible purgatory, I'll start preaching. It ain't in there. When you die, you either go into heaven or hell. And the choice is not up to God. The choice is up to you.
Amen.
God made his choice when he put Jesus on that cross.
Amen.
That he died for everybody's sin.
Amen.
Now you've got to receive him as your Savior, as your Lord. And if you don't do that, then you're going to a hot place. And you're going to be there for eternity, the Bible says. Now, I'm not a smart fellow. But I've got better sense to know, hey, there's one place I don't want to go. And that's a place called hell in the Bible. But you make that choice. And hey, let me say this to you. You don't miss hell because you belong to Stop the Baptist Church. This church has no power to get you to heaven. None whatsoever. Well, they told me if I joined the church, I'd go to heaven. Somebody lied to you. That's not in this Bible. Nowhere in this Bible ever tell you to join a church. Oh, boy. Well, you think I ought to be a member of a church? I do, if you're saved. You want to be with the family of God? Amen. I believe you do. But that's not what's going to get you there. He said, this day thou shalt be with me. It's a prompt, personal answer, a prompt answer. And it's a promising now. Shall thou be with me? How many of you believe Jesus can keep a promise?
Amen.
He made this old boy a promise. You say, well, where is he now, preacher? He's with Jesus. The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I believe that. I believe if I fall over any minute, and I could. You say, well, you look hefty. That's because I'm fat as a hawk. You think everybody fat. That not be true always. I've had so many parts taken out, parts put in, that I'm a whatever. You name it, I'm it. Thou shalt be with me. Do you want to be with him? You're going to have to do the same thing this old boy did. Lord, remember me. Lord, help me. God loves you, friend. God loves you more than anybody on this earth. You say, well, I'm not doing right, preacher. God still loves you. The love of God never changes. If you die and go to a place called hell, God still love you. He'll love you all the way. All the way. Thou shalt be with me in paradise. Jesus answered the prayer that he said in the first statement. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And here he is doing it. He was the mediator and our high priest in that first statement. Now here he's Lord. He's God. Preacher, I just don't know what to do. I tell you what, make sure that you know him. You can meet all the famous people in the world, and it won't change your life. But if you ever meet Jesus, you'll be a different person, I promise you. You'll be a different person. Let's stand to our feet, please.